actually, which is being regularly conducted for the last couple of months since we are in the epidemics and we could not virtually physically meet. So this was the one, as Dr. explained by Dr. Nagendra, we have been conducting alternate Sundays the webinars, and through that one only we have been communicating on the various aspects of the allergy and immunology. The first speaker is from our neighboring country, Bangladesh. We have with us Dr. Wahidul Alam, who is well known to us for a long time. Dr. Wahidul Alam actually graduated from Sofia Medical Academy, Bulgaria in 1980. And then he did his MD in medicine as well as PhD from the same institution in 1994 and 1985 respectively. His interest actually was between the relationship between the asthma and the gastric ulcer. After finishing his studies there, Dr. Wahidul Alam returned to Bangladesh to serve his nation, and he joined the Chittagong Medical College, Government Medical College Chittagong, to his native place, and he continued for some time and then returned to the private practice on allergy, asthma and immunology. Dr. Wahidul Alam was president of the Chittagong unit of the Private Doctors Association in Bangladesh. There is a Private Doctors Association with thousands of people in the country, and he has been heading that for the 4 consecutive years as president of the Chittagong unit. He has several publications to his credit. His interest also lies in writing books and short stories and contemporary events. I'm glad to welcome him as a fellow of the Indian College of Allergy and Applied Immunology. He has been associated with the college for a long time now, and he has been attending regularly meetings of the Indian College of Allergy and Applied Immunology. If I remember correctly, he attended the Lucknow meeting last when we met. With this brief background, I will now invite Dr. Wahidul Alam to speak on his topic on indoor hobby allergies causing asthma in Bangladesh. Probably he will be talking more about the aquarium allergy in Bangladesh. Dr. Wahidul Alam, please share your
respected chairman and distinguished participants from India and abroad. This is my privilege to speak in this webinar session by ICAI. I take this opportunity to thank ICAI committee in general and Dr. Abhi Singh, Dr. P.C. Kathuria, Dr. Nagendra Kamrala, Professor B.K. Jain, with whom I have been attending ICAI conference since 1990. Dear friends, we are connected by webinar today at a very harsh time that human civilization ever experienced. In Bangladesh, till today, 321 doctors died due to COVID. I start my deliberation with deep respect for those front fighters against corona in India, Bangladesh, and other parts of the world who lost their lives in fight against corona. So, dear friends, my first deliberation
I think we should mute everyone because there is some background sound coming up.
You can share the slides now.
Yes, yes, yes. First slide I will give you.
Yeah.
First slide. This is, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. This is first slide. I start with our lone Nobel laureate, Dr. Inouye, who is known throughout the world as banker to the poor. It was in 2006, immediately after getting his Nobel laureate in Chittagong.
You can make your presentation full screen.
I start with lead item of the lecture, aquarium related asthma. Here I start with showing I am from coastal region of Indian subcontinent as usual. This is a boat made by our craftsmen 700 years before Christ. This vessel is preserved in Maritime Museum in Germany. So bronchial asthma is mostly an allergic disease. Many known and unknown allergens can cause bronchial asthma. Even with increasing number of allergen in the skin testing kit, we miss lot of allergens. In such pretext, aquarium related asthma was detected clinically. It is basically an evidence-based study. So when we suspect that some indoor allergens are there, when we have symptoms round the year, number two, when symptoms get worse in cold months, because during cold months, one stays more time indoor. Number three, when after a skin test and allergen avoidance, patients cannot improve their symptoms. Symptoms continue to persist even after aggressive therapy. When despite aggressive therapy, symptoms do not improve to desired level, we should suspect that some internal criminals, indoor criminals are there. Now, what is aquarium? It is a taboo for the new riches of Bangladesh. Due to socioeconomic uplift of population, tremendous social changes occurred in Bangladesh during last 2-3 decades, which led to changed lifestyle of new riches. This section of population have bizarre hobbies. One such popular hobby is aquarium at home. Neither doctors nor the population had any suspicion that aquarium could cause asthmatic symptoms. So in that pretext, I took this study. We had altogether 74 patients. All of them were from Chittagong. 60 were male, 14 were female, and age were between 7 to 30 years. So these were young group of people. And they had, all of them, they had clinical symptoms of asthma throughout year, perennial symptoms, wheezing 88% of the patients, 72% had cough, 90%. Running nose 90%, sneezing 92%, and perennial discomfort 90%. Here I must mention that among all these symptoms, they were complaining more of sneezing and running nose. This overweight other clinical symptoms of bronchial asthma. So amongst 74 patients, here I just mentioned, they, after getting treatment in Bangladesh, they get despaired and wanted to take treatment abroad. Out of these 74 patients, 32.43% got treatment in Bangladesh, 27% in India, 10% in Bangkok, 12 patients in Singapore and 8 patients in USA. Other than India, other countries do not go for skin allergy test. Among those three,
we lost connectivity, Dr. Vaidulal.
Sir, can you hear, sir?
We can hear, but there is no. Hello, there is no PowerPoints.
No, you can go to the share again. Go to the share.
Okay, I am waiting.
Dr. Alam, you have to share this screen again.
Yes.
Once you go to the share, then you go to the projection mode. That is a screen mode.
Now is it okay, sir?
No. You have to go to the projection mode. There is a bottom line. There is a screen is there. You click on the screen, bottom line, so that your PowerPoint will become enlarged.
Slideshow.
No. Still bottom. Come to the bottom.
Bottom.
Bottom of the screen.
Bottom of the screen.
Go to the bottom, sir.
It's okay. We can read it. Let us continue with this.
Okay, you can go ahead, sir. No. It is.
Share mat karo, bhaiya. Share karo.
Unshare ho gaya. Abhi to share karna hai.
Aise hi chalo.
Now it is okay.
Let it be like that.
Nahi. Abhi it's okay. Abhi to double click karke dekho. Yeah.
Double click karo.
Okay. Okay, sir. Go ahead, sir. Dr. Hoyt, go ahead.
Okay. Among 74 patients, 24 got treatment in Bangladesh, 20 in India, 10 in Bangkok, 12 in Singapore, 8 in USA. Other than India, those who got treatment in other countries did not go for allergy test. Doctors there did not advise them to go for allergy test. Among those treated in India, 8 were given hyposensitization therapy, parenteral. Other got only inhalers and conventional bronchodilator therapy with montelukast. Those treated in Bangkok, Singapore, and USA were prescribed only inhalers and montelukast. All patients did not get significant improvement. Interestingly, nowhere while taking case history, neither consulting doctor nor the patients disclosed that they had aquarium at their house, fish aquarium. Next. So all the patients were asked to remove aquarium. 11 patients did not remove aquarium and continued to have asthmatic symptoms as before. 38 patients stopped all medication, including occasional inhalers, and were symptom free. 9 patients were able to hold on only with salbutamol and steroid inhalers. 54 patients were followed up for 3 years on every 3 months and were symptom free without any medication, even with occasional inhalers. Clinical improvement of asthmatic symptoms definitely show some relation between allergens in the aquarium and bronchial asthma. The allergens could be either in the scales of fishes or in the decorative plants, herbs used in the aquarium. Environment in the aquarium is a perfect place for growth of mold. It is a paradox that sometimes nature's deadliest chemical often come in beautiful circumstances like palytoxin, which is found as waste in the aquarium and which cause severe respiratory reaction. Planktonic algae also releases palytoxin. So in my circumstances, I did not have adequate lab facilities to extract possible allergens from aquarium. So I urge upon interested allergologist to take this propagation further. Aquarium related asthma is a new entity. I urge upon interested researchers to come forward to put into solid scientific basis. For this, some more works should be undertaken. So I conclude with these few words and again thank all the participants and Indian College of Allergy, Asthma and Immunology for giving me this privilege to speak few words in front of this August gathering. Thank you, sir.
You can close the slides now, Dr. Roy. You can unshare.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Wahidul Alam, for your very brief and crisp presentation on aquarium allergy. In fact, still there is a lot to be done, as you yourself have suggested. It needs to be worked out more in detail, actually, finding the causative agents, whether it's the molds or the algal fragments or the skin fish scale, because fish is well known. The skins are also, fish skins are also known to cause allergic diseases. So, I mean, there is a scope for understanding this, but indirectly you have already inferred that the people after removing the aquarium, they were found to be benefited from their allergic symptoms. Now I will invite if there is any question from the audience. Yes, Dr. Wahidul. I remember you asked me once, how can we get the allergens from aquarium?
But even after those 74 patients, I continue to get patients here. And I never forget from then on to ask them whether they have aquarium at home and whether they have pet birds. That is also a new hobby, keeping different birds at home. So all of those get bronchial asthma symptoms throughout the year perennial year, and nothing can prevent it. Montelukast or any inhalers, steroid inhalers cannot prevent it.
Yeah, avoidance is the best treatment. That's good. Did you also look into, Dr. Wahidul, some of the fishermen who are directly involved every day into this fishing business? Did you get any opportunity to get some data from them?
Yes, maybe they don't have aquarium in a closed space.
Yeah.
But fishing as a profession, I did not get that they have this sort of symptoms. But here maybe there are some herbs, algaes, or fish foods put in the aquarium, which could cause, and palytoxin is severely bronchoconstrictor, severely bronchoconstrictor.
Anybody?
Sir. Yes, sir. Can I come in, please?
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, with the permission of the chair, can I ask questions?
Yeah.
Dr. Haidul Alam, you are exposure to the new thinking and new avenues, this particular toxin which you have said, how you see the aquarium will be with the water container, and this, how you encounter that this becomes an airborne allergen, one. Number two, you see, you said that immunotherapy were put on these patients and they have diagnosed and then the therapy started and they have shown some improvement. What are the common allergens which has been found positive and what immunotherapy was given? So these two things which may help us, whether it's a cross-reactive to the allergens which is found in the aquarium and may be related. So number three, you see, most of the, not only in India, even in abroad also same thing happening, what you said, they may not go for immunotherapy, they go for a blood test and they stop it. Or some people, they do the skin prick test and they stop it. and they will not be advised to go for immunotherapy at all. That means the immunotherapy is not well understood by the doctors and they are not motivated to go for immunotherapy. So I think we had to collectively we had to think and then we had to do the effective immunotherapy which is recently found and which can stop the inhalers in the long term and we can deliver the quality of life and also keep these people away from the biologicals which is coming into the market now. So these are things which we had to highlight and we had to do further.
Yes, that. But here, those tested in India, only 8% were tested for skin test. Although they have given them immunotherapy as per skin test result, even then they did not get expected result. There comes the question that the dominant allergens and dominant feature is in the aquarium, not in other tested allergens. So that's why I emphasize that aquarium there are allergens which maybe we could not detect. Those could be the causing factor. And after removing the aquarium from the environment, from their house, their situation, their symptoms immediately started to get improved.
Probably this aquarium may be acting as a irritant, like a smoke or a smell and other things. So this aquarium also may be emitting a lot of the gases from the aquarium, which may be inducing the problem. Once you eliminate it, the recovery may be faster.
That's why we should be aware of indoor allergens as well, not to look for outdoor allergens. That is, looking for outdoor allergen is okay. That is, we cannot avoid it. But indoor allergens also, we should be careful. And those patients who get perennial symptoms, who don't get improved after aggressive therapy, who don't get improved after immunotherapy, I think we should think of not only of aquarium, some other indoor allergens also you must think of.
Dr. Vaidul, did you encounter some of the skin diseases in these patients? Because they are the one who are cleaning and tubing and they are more exposed to the skin part rather, or once they get dried up while changing the water and while changing the food material, probably they could have been exposed.
No, rich people, what we call neuriches, they themselves do it, not their mates or other helpers, because it is their hobby. Even class 4-5 students, they are involved in this. So they get these symptoms, bronchospasm symptoms. They don't use maids and others.
Dr. Aidul. Yeah, it's a wonderful presentation from your side and it's your experience. And what I want to say is that you already said in your talk that the patient was given immunotherapy and did not respond. First, it is not clear to which he was given the immunotherapy, the name of the antigens. But what I feel that the probably, is it not the toxic effect of the substance which you already said, which is present in the aquarium? It's not allergy. It may be just a toxic reactions to that. And then once you remove that particular thing, then the particular substance has gone. So there is no allergy. That's what I feel. If you say that allergy positivity, you have to concretely support that, okay, it was positive for this. What you said is probably this known as is a toxic substance. So it may be producing toxic reactions in the lungs and producing cough or dyspnea or whatever. May not be even allergic. And even the avoidance of these toxic reactions might have subsided. And then patient has recovered well.
I agree with you. Actually, before 10-15 years, if you remember, I first talked about this fish aquarium in Jalandhar, ICAA conference in Jalandhar, Punjab. So after, as a sequel of that conferences, Dr. Abhi Singh proposed me to send this fish aquarium liquid to Delhi. Accordingly, he extracted some powder, he advised me to test it as an allergen. Unfortunately, it did not reach me somehow, and we lost the track. I think now who are in Delhi or around Delhi living in India, you could put it into solid scientific basis. There are toxic materials, that is understood, but why not to detect some allergens? Because algae, mold, they grow sufficiently in aquarium. And aquarium is a perfect place, perfect environmental place for growth of such allergens. So I think it is your job, and you have all these facilities, amenities, to find out what is the reason, what are the allergens.
That is a proper channel, actually. But what I want to say again is that probably some things which are there, and you said the molds are also present. I think that those are important. If you find out some allergens,
yes,
then we can contribute along with some laboratory findings of rust or something in the that particular allergen, that it is allergy. Otherwise, I still feel it is some toxic syndrome.
Let me clarify, Dr. Gaur.
Yeah.
Actually, because we are in touch with Dr. Wahidul Alam for a long time now. He had suspected that probably aquarium water may be responsible for some of his symptomatic patients there. So he sent some material. We extracted the antigen volume by volume rather than weight by volume. And then lyophilized it and sent it to back. But that does not cannot pinpoint specific allergens in that, whether it's the fish scale, whether it's the algae or is the mold or some other items. But at least this should have given some idea whether they are actually showing any skin reactivity to one of the components present in that allergen. But unfortunately, he could not receive that allergen. Somewhere it was lost during the transportation.
Dr. Singh, I agree. But if the fluid is having some problem, I think it should start from the skin problem. I think that's what I feel.
Yeah, this is what I also, that's why I asked this question, whether those who are handling with that one, they had that some...
They should start with the skin problem, local irritant or local allergy or
but
whatever.
But this toxic, maybe, I don't know whether it's a volatile organic solvent so that the people can inhale. That needs to be studied.
Yeah, that needs to be worked out. Unless we know the particular allergen, we cannot, I think, say that it is allergic to something. And because the people who are using fish, they are very fond of using this thing. Once you say that this is allergic, you remove it. You should have some concrete evidence, scientific evidence that, okay, this is this, and therefore we are asking you to remove it.
Yes, Dr. Agarwal, please.
Dr. Ubaidul Alam has raised a very interesting question about aquarium-related allergens. As Dr. A.B. Singh said, it could be pollen, it can be fungi, it can be algae. We did long ago algae allergy work in 1960s. It can be chemicals, whatever are used. And it can be toxins, as Dr. Gaur said. And Dr. Ubaidul Alam himself says that we have to investigate it further to find out the actual culprit, whether it is allergy or whether it is a toxin reaction. Besides that, I want to raise some question which is not related to this subject. What Dr. Nagen Prasad said is about the allergy testing and immunotherapy. I would like to say only thing that we have got four types of allergy clinics in our country. One is where no allergy testing is done. Number two, allergy testing are done, no immunotherapy is given. And number four type is where the testing is done by blood and immunotherapy is given without seeing the patient. So basically, we have to spread the, as a College of Allergy, as well as all the participants in this webinar, that doing skin testing alone does not help the patient. And doing unethical practice of doing blood test and doing immunotherapy without seeing the patient is also completely unethical. We should do something about it. And what I would be more concerned about, the persons who are running the allergy clinics, doing the skin test, and then they are not doing anything with respect to immunotherapy. This should be taken very seriously, and awareness to nahi, aisa nahi hai ki we do not know. They don't know about the importance of immunotherapy. Only thing is the time required is a little too much. So this is a very important issue which the college should take up and deliberate upon it and issue guidelines with respect to starting any allergy clinic. Testing with the skin test and just forgetting about it is of no use to the patient. Maybe they can allow advice for some avoidance, but when it comes to aeroallergens, most of the time we are not able to avoid them. this was very important. But when it comes to the original, there are people who are, one question somebody raised, that aerosolization of the allergen from the aquarium. Well, there is a oxygen drop, oxygen bubbles are going through that water and the aerosol is generated. So therefore anything and everything will go in the air, that can be pollen, mold, that can be algae, that can be toxin, that can be fish scale, whatever it is, we have to, if we find that this is a significant problem, then one should take up the research on different aspects of this particular, whether it is toxin or not, we will know only after doing the test.
Doctor, while I want to add one thing.
I want to reply to Dr. Agarwal, sir.
The bubbles cannot produce aerosol, doctor. I'm sorry, Dr. Agarwal, sir. It has to be a spray or it has to be something like under pressure. Only then the aerosols are produced. Bubbles cannot produce aerosols. This is my saying.
If there are some volatile substances, they can be go to the air.
You see, Dr. Agarwal, I don't know whether
we can discuss later on. That Kathuria.
Oxygen is passed through pressure.
Yeah, the
bubble
cannot come without pressure.
Sir. Thank you, Dr. Adela. Well, we appreciate your efforts. It is a new entity, but as per se, the diagnosis of asthma should not be here. It is just a hypersensitivity reaction, because once we use the term asthma, it consists of the two things. One is the inflammation, and second was the airway remodeling. You have to confirm whether the airway remodeling was there or not, because if you look for the obstruction, patient get free once you stop, once you avoid the aquarium. Then the obstruction was there or not, because until unless we monitor symptomatology on the basis of the symptomatology. You see, symptoms and obstructions are indirectly, they are not proportional to each other. And second terminology which is being used by you, that the patient, it has got some toxins. You see, toxins are there. It is there, but it is not going to induce persistent airway obstruction. That patient, you see, patient is going, everything is going, it is a transient phenomenon. But once it persists, then it converted to the inflammation and the airway obstruction. And second is that, is it a already pre-existing inflammation that you have to confirm? If example is there in the aquarium, two things you mentioned, algae. Second one you mentioned, the fish was there. Which fish has got a three component, out of which two components becomes airborne. Tropomyosin is there. Another component is there, that arginine kinase, it also becomes airborne. Once you open the aquarium, it may become airborne. These factors may be there, but it has to be correlated with the other allergens also. Algae, as per se, the literature says, in the aquarium, so far, it does not become airborne. It will be there, toxins are there, but it is rarely to get it. As per the literature on aquarium-induced asthma, there is no entity is there. So, hypersensitivity we can use, but one should not use the word asthma.
Fine. We basically, what Dr. Ubaidul Alam said, Dr. Kathuria, and Dr. Gaur, whatever you all are saying is right. More work has to be done. This is hypersensitivity reaction. It's fine. But he has very clearly said that more work is needed on different aspects, whether it is toxin, whether it is allergy, whether it is non-allergic, allergic, pollen, algae or fungi, or because usually we put reagents, chemicals there where there is very little growth of algae or very little growth of fungi there.
But Dr. Agarwal, what I have understood from Dr. Kathuria, is questioning the diagnosis of asthma actually.
No, diagnosis of asthma.
Wrong with the triggers.
I will be very reluctant.
I can look up parameters, but simple. In a clinical setup, what he could do naturally.
That's it. That's what I'm saying. More work has to be done if you want to do that.
That's fine.
That also should be done.
Actually,
there
what
was one more. Okay.
Sir, to add to Dr. Kathuria,
yeah.
I can add that if it was from chemical reaction, then maybe a whole family would have got it. But not whole family reacts to such a reaction. Only particular person, one person maybe, or not two persons even I did not get. one person, he gets this sort of things, and all the components of asthmatic symptoms are there. So this is more of allergic cause than of any chemical. Well,
it is a circumstantial evidence.
Just a small information I want to share with Hoidal. You see, the furniture is also having a chemicals which is emitted, and yes, these chemicals also emitted and also induces the allergies and also aggravating the problem only sensitive people, not to the normal people. Similarly, in aquarium also, it emits some toxins, and which may be a chemical which we are not identified, and we may identify in the later days to come, and it may be inducing. But once you remove the source, the allergen factors or the severity will come down and they may be normal. So at this juncture, I think we will not discuss more on those points until unless we identify the allergen.
One thing I would like to comment, as far as the diagnosis is concerned, not only Dr. Ordil, many of the country people of Western countries, they have never questioned the diagnosis of asthma and they continued with the inhaled therapy. So I don't think that there is a problem with the diagnosis.
Yes.
Is there any other question?
It is the five countries, or four or five countries, they have never questioned.
It is sir, please.
Bronchial hyperreactivity.
It is based on the subjective and objective parameters. There must be some objective parameters.
He has not mentioned, but I agree. He has not agreed. I agree. He has not given the reason. But it was never questioned by any of the physicians, neither in India nor abroad, nor in Bangladesh itself. So I think we should not question like that.
We are not here to define asthma, Dr. Kathuria. Fine, okay.
Which can lead to some bronchial hyperreactivity, maybe in the asthmatic form or something, anything, whatever it may be. But what he has pointed out, and that should be taken in history, because we don't take such kind of history in India.
Clinical history and physical examination is the core way of diagnosing. Yeah. The remaining tests are only confirmatory. So therefore, we have been mostly, there is 99% correlation of the patient clinical history and symptoms and physical examination with the any FEV1 test or anything. So therefore, I think that becomes a little too much fine-tuning. We should, we know that more work has to be done.
Actually, Dr. Wahidul Alam has given us a way that there is a situation where you can go and study in depth.
Yes.
And yes, try exactly to find out this work. And yes, he has clearly accepted that we have done the basic background work. It is up to you, because you have research facilities, you have got the analysis, you have got well-identified asthmatics. So you go ahead and do that. I mean, that he has shown the way.
That I agree, Dr. Singh, is an observation from him, actually.
Yeah, observation.
He already said that it needs a further evaluation. I think I agree with that 100%.
Hello.
Okay. Hello? Thank you. Is there any other question?
Go to the second presentation now.
Only 2 minutes.
Hello. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes. Yes.
Bolie.
Lot of things has already said. I will not go detail. Yeah. But what more important is the environmental study of the houses or homes of those patients are also much really needed. The environmental study, we have to visit the actual site of the patient's home, how they are living, and all these things, they are also required too much.
We have done that. Let Wahidul Alam invite to Chittagong. We'll go and study.
I'm inviting you, sir, to do something.
Dr. Alam has already invited us.
An area of research.
Whole team will be requested, maybe invited to Bangladesh, and we all researchers will find out something new. Definitely, really, we need is a area of real research. We need it, and what others have already said, we need all these things: the testing, the environmental, the living status, the food habits, and all these things we really need. But definitely, he has opened our eyes to.
Actually, unfortunately, if you see the number of aquarium which in our country people have, is very limited. We don't have many people having aquarium. There was this type of work has to be done in places like Sri Lanka, where this hobby is there. And in our country, I don't think we will be able to undertake any research, whether it is environmental study or
the challenges.
But collaborative work can be done.
No, in the recent times, the aquarium has become a trade, and it has been motivated to most of the offices as well as in the houses. So you can see number of shops, aquarium shops are available, and it has become a very common now in the most of the posh areas and posh buildings. They put this aquarium, and also this they act as a vastu positive moods which has been generated by aquariums. So the aquariums are coming into the picture now. I think here Dr. Oidul Alam has opened a chapter, and he has given a thought. I think everybody has to look into the aquariums and see whether it is inducing any problem or not.
Moreover, it is a stress buster also. You see, in some of the countries, they love to have a fish every time they want to see, because have a fish in your house, then they say you should be active like this. So, like.
Thank you, Dr. Vaidur Alam, for generating very interesting questions and observations among the panelists. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your lively discussion, your questions, and we hope we can find out some solution in future.
Sure.
We'll try our Thank you.
Friends, we have got now the second speaker, who is none other than Dr. Anil Kumar Jain. He is a senior consultant and head department of allergy and asthma and immunology at National Institute of Tuberculosis and Respiratory Diseases, New Delhi. Many of you might remember that he organized the 53rd annual convention of the Indian College of Allergy and Applied Immunology at his institute in 2019. Dr. Jain is basically, he has published more than 30 research publications and has written chapters in books also. And today he will speak on biologicals in allergy and their cost effectiveness. That is very, very important in these days. There are very big confrontation with biologicals and immunotherapy. There is a So we have to have a balanced approach. I think Dr. Anil Jain will definitely enlarge over it. Thank you, Dr. Jain. Please join.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for kind words, sir. And should I share my screen?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Share it from here. Yeah.
So without wasting much time, I would like to start, because my topic is a bit lengthier.
Dr. Jain, can you put it in the projection mode? Yeah, that's right.
Thank you, dear friends, and good afternoon for giving me an opportunity to speak on a topic which is, I think, very important as far as not only the drugs or the biologicals, but its cost implications in the control and management of the different allergic conditions, not simply asthma. So just for the introduction, allergies affect about 1 million world population, and 36%, almost one third of population, roughly 40 to 45 crores of Indian populations are suffering from some form of the allergies. The oldest biological therapy for allergy that is still in current use is the allergic immunotherapy. But I'm not going to speak on this. That is a separate and lengthy topic itself. The treatment options of, excuse me, can I remove this? Sorry. It's creating a problem. Right. Treatment options for the respiratory and dermatological diseases have expanded considerably during the past 10 years, improving the quality of life of many people with chronic, debilitating, poorly controlled allergic conditions. Humanized antibodies that target essential cytokine receptors, and soluble or membrane-bound IgE are a promising approach to the treatment of asthma, atopic dermatitis, urticaria, allergic rhinitis and sinusitis, and food allergy, and some of which are already in use. And current approach targeting type 2 immunity seems to affect overlapping patients group and produce similar final pathophysiological outcomes. That is, a same pathophysiological in different type of allergies. Patients with non-type 2 response, such as intrinsic type of atopic dermatitis, non-eosinophilic asthma, chronic rhinosinusitis without nasal polyps, neutrophilic asthma, and obesity-induced asthma have not so far been efficiently targeted by the biologicals. identification of biomarkers that accurately and objectively examine pathogenic process and responses to the therapeutic intervention is critical for the development of the individual therapies. A new term, therotype, has been coined to describe subsets of patients that respond well to a certain therapeutic intervention. Some of the most promising biological therapies that target IgE, interleukin 5, 4, and 13, and with new monoclonal antibodies being developed and approved at a rapid pace, choosing the best again agent for each clinical situation can be a formidable task. So it is simply just a slide to show that there are so many targets and there are so many effects, but I'm not going to in details because they are under evaluation. Only those who are in, you can say, very, very near to the market or available in the market, I'm going to talk about that. So immunological therapies in, biological therapies in asthma, the classification of asthma has shifted from focusing on symptom triggers such as allergic, infectious, or exercise-induced asthma. It has been nominated now T2 high and T2 low asthma. T2 low asthma is characterized by having normal airway eosinophil and neutrophil counts or elevated airway neutrophil counts, while T2 high asthma is typically defined by elevated airway eosinophil counts, but elevated peripheral eosinophil counts, blood periostin level, fractional exhaled nitric oxide, and allergen-specific IgE levels have been used as surrogate markers. The classification of asthma has shifted from focusing to simple. So use of amylizumab in asthma as a biological agent. The amylizumab is already in vogue since 2003 and has been approved by FDA for patients 6 years and older with moderate to severe asthma and group 5, you can say, stage 5. Amylizumab decreases asthma exacerbation rate by approximately 40% overall and more than 60% if blood eosinophil count is more than 300 cells per microliter and improve the total asthma score and reduce the use of risky albuterol. Omalizumab confers clinically meaningful improvements in forced expiratory volume in 1 second. That is a questionable, how much it gives, whether it is satisfactory or not. It is not accepted by all one. The lung function can be improved. However, it is not clear also how long omalizumab should be continued, as for the possibility of discontinuation of omalizumab treatment after an average of, you can say, roughly 2 years, 22.7 months of treatment, 55% patient develop a loss of control within a median period of 13 months. Second is the dupilumab, which is not available right now in various parts of the countries, but supposed to be a good drug. A humanized monoclonal antibody, which inhibits both IL-4 and 13 and decreases IgE production by 40%. Phase 3 studies have been completed and results reported by the manufacturers through a press release is that at 12 weeks, in 300 milligram dupilumab, dose group mean improvement in FEV1 was 9% in overall population, 11% in patient with eosinophil counts of 150 cells per microliter, 18% in patient with eosinophil counts of 300 cells per microliter, and after 1 year of therapy with 300 milligram twice a month dupilumab reduced the severe asthma attack by 46% in overall population, 60% in patient with eosinophil counts of 150 cells per microliter, and 67% in patient with eosinophil counts 300 cells per microliter or greater. But dupilumab is not yet FDA approved for the treatment of asthma. However, it will likely to be dosed subcutaneously every 2 weeks with home administration. This is mepolizumab, racilizumab, and benralizumab in asthma. Mepolizumab is already available in India, but racilizumab and benralizumab is available outside. Given the important role of eosinophils, the monoclonal antibodies have been developed to target IL-5. Mepolizumab and racilizumab bind directly to IL-5 and prevents it from binding IL-5 receptors, while benralizumab binds to the alpha subunit of the IL-5 receptor on eosinophils and basophils, which prevents IL-5 binding and enhances one extra, you can say, action is there. Enhances antibody-dependent cell-mediated cytotoxicity of these cells. So just a picture, you can see the IL-5, once it is attached to the basophils or they activate the eosinophils, they produce this more and more eosinophils and basophils. That is the signaling cascade leading to activation, proliferation, and recruitment of eosinophil and basophils. Here you can neutralize the IL-5 by this mepolizumab and rosnilimab. So there is no action or there is no, there is absence of the signaling and there is no, you can say, activation of these things. But in case of benralizumab, which usually binds to the alpha subunit of the IL-5 receptor, it can not only one part prevents this cascade. The second part is that ADCC, what you say, is the antibody-dependent cell-mediated toxicity. They also kill the these basophils and the basophils and the mast cells. So these are just two just one difference between the two. So a Cochrane systemic review evaluated 13 studies that involved 6,000 participants. The severe eosinophilic asthma, 4 used mepolizumab, 4 used rosnilimab, and 5 used benralizumab. All the anti-IL-5 treatment assessed reduced the rates of clinically significant asthma exacerbation of approximately 50%. Modest improvements in validated health-related quality of life scores with all anti-IL-5 agents were found, but the asthma control questionnaires and asthma quality of life questionnaire score did not exceed the minimum clinically important difference. All anti-IL-5 treatments produced a small but statistically significant improvement in mean pre-bronchodilator FEV1 from 80 ml to 110 ml only. So which one to use? This is basically, I will come to this picture later on. Characterization of the patient with asthma by phenotype and ultimately endotype will likely lead to more rational use of the biologicals. For T2 high allergic asthma, omalizumab is likely the therapy of choice. For T2 high non-allergic eosinophilic asthma, the IL-5 blockers or dupilumab can be used. So we can see here that they have plotted this graph, or you can say a picture, serum total IgE more than 30 on this side and eosinophil count more than 300 on this side, peripheral eosinophil count. So if we have only less than 300 eosinophil and more than 30 IgE, atopic asthma, omalizumab is enough. Go to this side. If there is more than 30 IgE and more than 300 eosinophils, then both are the choice. Which one to be preferred? I prefer omalizumab. And then if patient doesn't respond, only then IL-5 is to be given. Here again, more than 300 cells, but less than, you can say, non-atopic type of asthma, less than 30 IgE. Anti-IL-5 is the choice. And this group, where there is no eosinophil is less than 300, IgE is also less. So T2 high, T2 low asthma, the thromboplasty, macrolide, weight loss, and many other things can be the choice, but not the biologicals. Similarly, the use of biologicals in anticarial diseases, although first-line therapy consists of high-dose second-generation antihistamines, a significant number, approximately 50% of the patients, do not achieve adequate control. Adjunct therapies such as tacrolimus, cyclosporine, and dapsone can be effective in certain patients, but may cause adverse effects. Therefore, there is a great interest in biologicals as alternative therapy options for the chronic urticaria. And the biologicals with most prominent data from large-scale chronic urticaria studies include omalizumab and interleukin-1 antagonists. Omalizumab is FDA approved for chronic urticaria in adults and in adolescent, 12 years and above, and older than, remains symptomatic despite antihistaminics. One of the potential pathologic mechanism involved in chronic urticaria is autoantibodies directed against IgE or against alpha chain of the Fc epsilon receptor 1. Thus, omalizumab can simultaneously inhibit both these pathological mechanisms by inducing a significant reduction in serum IgE level which subsequently triggers internalization of this Fc epsilon receptor 1 of mast cell. This internalization, I would like to say, that is not only neutralization, but internalization, I will show you in picture. And can you see this omalizumab treatment was associated with a 73% reduction in basophil receptor 1, Fc epsilon receptor 1, within 7 days, and 90% reduction in the basophil responsiveness at 90 days. So it has a dual action. One is the neutralization. Here I have shown this picture that these are the receptors. This is the neutralization. But apart from this, these receptors which are present on the surface, they also get absorbed again, you can say, or internalization. What I have told you, so omalizumab have the added benefit that it reduces the receptors on the surface, and that can also reduce the CVIT and the reactions of, you can say, allergens. In addition, omalizumab improves angioedema-related symptoms. And who have hives and angioedema, omalizumab has also been used to treat urticarial vasculitis, including cholinergic, physical urticarias, you can say cholinergic, cold, heat, delayed pressure. New guidelines currently under review suggest that omalizumab should be considered earlier. Means if the patient is not working with the histiocytes, go directly with the omalizumab rather than coming to the cyclosporine and all that. That is also under consideration. Interleukin was just few words because we don't use it. And what I was reading in the literature, that several family autoinflammatory syndromes of the CAPS in short, or cryopyrin associated peripheral, something like that, spectrum such as Muckel's familial cold autoinflammatory syndrome and neonatal onset multisystem inflammatory disease are associated with recurrent urticaria. The FDA has approved 3 IL-1 antagonists for the CAPS, denecanumab and a recombinant human IL-1, the canakinumab, and the third is the rilonacept. And in studies examining the enakinumab and canakinumab in patients of the Schnitzler syndrome, characterized by fever, myalgia, lymphadenopathy, and urticaria, have had favorable results. But the effects of these biological patients with chronic idiopathic urticaria and urticarial vasculitis has to be examined in large scale trials. Another is the nasal polyps. No biological therapies are currently FDA approved for the nasal polyps as a grid, but omalizumab and dupilumab are being examined in phase 3 clinical trial. The effect of omalizumab on nasal polyposis were examined in a randomized double-blind trial. A proof of concept with 24 allergic and non-allergic patients with nasal polyposis and concomitant asthma. The omalizumab decreased total nasal polyps score, anosmia, and other nasal symptoms, and sinus pacification. However, nasal tissue inflammation was not decreased. Use of mepolizumab improved nasal polyp endoscopy scores, especially in patients with higher pre-treatment nasal IL-5 levels, but did not significantly improve the nasal symptom scores in proof of a concept study in individuals with nasal polyposis. Long-term studies with subcutaneous mepolizumab before surgery, assessing surgery prevention, and evaluation after surgery, assessing effect of recurrence, is warranted. The effects of IL-4 and 13, IL-13 inhibition by dupilumab on nasal polyps has been examined. A proof of concept study of dupilumab reported a decrease in nasal polyp scores and nasal symptoms scores in randomized double-blind placebo trial of 60 patients with subcutaneous dupilumab along with the administration of the conjunction with the intranasal mometasone for 16 weeks. And the author concluded that among adults with symptomatic chronic sinusitis and nasal polyposis refractory to intranasal corticosteroids, the addition of subcutaneous dupilumab to mometasone furoate nasal spray compared with mometasone alone reduced endoscopic nasal polyp burden after 16 weeks. So dupilumab is currently the only FDA-approved biological agent in the US and Europe, most probably that will also be available in India in coming years. Atopic dermatitis, use of the biologicals. Although there are many innate and adaptive cells, cytokines, other inflammatory mediators that contribute to pathogenesis of atopic dermatitis. The T2 cytokines, IL-4, 5, 13, appear to play some role. IgE was initially thought to be a valid therapeutic option, but only small case studies have been used on emalizumab, and the data are very, very mixed type of yes and no both. Dupilumab is the only FDA-approved biological agent for the treatment of atopic dermatitis. Dupilumab was recently approved for treatment of moderate to severe atopic dermatitis in patients with fixed dose of 300 milligrams subcutaneous twice a month. And a meta-analysis of 7 dupilumab phase 1, 2, and 3 trial blind double blind in roughly 2,000 patients. Can see. And all were age of 18, and this is the criteria of selection, you can say, 3 years of eczema, more than 10% of the surface area. I'm not going in detail, but the results are very good with the dupilumab if selected cases. Overall, dupilumab had a favorable safety profile and was also tolerated. The only thing that comes out to be the cost. How much cost is justified? Okay, I have given some studies, no Indian data are available, but whatever I got from the Western literature, I am putting it. Given the high cost of biologicals, understanding their cost effectiveness is critical. Most often cost effectiveness analysis compare difference in quality adjusted life years, and quality adjusted life years represents quality of life reported by patient in a given disease state under condition of risk, standardized such that one quality adjusted life years represent one perfect year of health. Zero means that represents death. This is a paper which was written for the role of omalizumab in different allergic conditions in Allergology International. The study is from Japan. They have also assessed the cost of the omalizumab in asthmatic cases and in allergic conditions. And they have examined the situation in Japan regarding cost effectiveness. Comparing the medical cost before and after use of omalizumab, medical costs were clearly reduced in patients who were hospitalized more than 8 times a year, but were the same or increased in patients with fewer hospitalizations. But the author has also given a very good conclusion. However, can we consider the effectiveness of the omalizumab in children only on the basis of health or care costs? Children are in the developmental stage. If asthma is relieved, they can exercise, attend school, reduce the number of hospital visits, and improve academic ability, social functioning, and psychological openness. So he has opined that you can compromise with the cost if these are the factors, especially in children, and both social and economic benefits can be expected in future. There was another study published in this Journal of Managed Care and Cancer Pharmacy, the heading, The Effectiveness and Value of Biological Therapy. And the evidence showed that all 5 drugs reduce the annual exacerbation rate by approximately 50% with broadly overlapping confidence. Means 3 IL-5, anti-IL-5, then dupilumab and omalizumab. Similarly, the effect on quality of life for all the drugs, as assessed by asthma quality of life questionnaire and by asthma control questionnaire, was similar, with modest but statistically significant improvements. All 5 of the drugs are more effective in patients with higher baseline eosinophil counts. Estimated the cost effectiveness of each of the 5 drugs compared with the standard of care using the Markov model that included 3 primary health states. And the 3 things they have considered are the asthma non-exacerbation state, then asthma exacerbation state, and 3rd is the death and hospitalization, and everything has been considered. And their observation is that as described in incremental cost, effective ratios, recent update to its value assessment framework, question on long-term value of money, are subject to a value vote only when incremental cost effectiveness ratio for the intervention of the interest rate, interest car, between 50,000 to 175,000 US dollar per QLY in the primary base case analysis. So they say it becomes cost effective when it is the cost is between 50,000 to 175,000 US dollar. And I'm showing a table that is comparing the all five biologicals exceed the higher end of the range. Thus, all the interventions were deemed low value without a vote of panel. You can see the cost per quality adjusted life year is more than 3 lakhs, while it should be less than 175,000. So they are off. I'm going to the conclusion later on. This is basically just to make that cost of the in US dollars, and you can compare with the Indian rates. So nothing to do with the cost effectiveness right now. So just to summarize my talk, the biologicals are useful in atopic conditions. Multiple allergies, or you can say overlapping allergies in a single patient, can be controlled effectively with these biologicals. Biologicals should be used at appropriate stages only for the best effect. None of the biologicals are cost effective on long-term basis except dupilumab in atopic dermatitis at present. Decrease in cost will make the biologicals used more cost effective. In fact, what I told you, in 2018 report states the cost of biologicals would need to be reduced between 60% to 80% from the wholesale acquisition cost to meet the cost effectiveness threshold. The cost is not a consideration. Biologicals are very effective otherwise. Other factors to be considered are children in the developmental stage. Thank you very much for your patience listening. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jain. A very, very informative lecture. In fact, this is a hot topic, other forms of treatment versus biologicals. And you have very clearly pointed out in the long run, actually, it is not cost effective.
Yes, sir.
However, keeping the Indian situations in mind, it is still not being uniformly practiced by everybody, and they have some constraints about the use of the biologicals also. But definitely, it has got a definite effect, rather than adjuvant effect, along with the immunotherapy also people are relying, particularly in the difficult asthma or eosinophilic asthma. With this, I would like to invite if there is Dr. Agarwal.
Sir, you have to unmute. You are muted, sir. Dr. Agarwal.
Dr. Agarwal, you unmute.
Yeah. Okay, Dr. Jain, I must congratulate you for such a succinct presentation on a very difficult subject. My question always I raise in multiple forums with respect to biologicals. The reason is that every particular interleukin or mediators, whatever the body is producing, has got some protective role in the body. When we antagonize them or use medicines or biologicals to counter them, we are compromising some other clinical condition in which they were going to be helpful. So the basic idea is that how much, at how much level we particular should bring IL-5 and IL-4 and IL-13. We are mostly worried about the one disease control, that is asthma, with disregarding the comorbidities. So basically there are many side effects which may be there. Some of may have been recorded, which may, and some may have been ignored or may be recorded later. I would like your expert opinion on that.
Well, frankly speaking, I have exposure of omalizumab, and it was when I was reading the literature. The maximum trials, or they have given 2 years or something like that. But there is a lady doctor in Delhi, in a government job, and she approached me roughly 4 years back for the urticaria, severe urticaria. And I offered this anti-IgE at that time. She was reluctant, but ultimately she agreed. But now she is very happy. She is almost roughly 4 years, 3.5 years or something like that.
And she said, my life has been very, very good. So in such a condition, and no side effect, no toxicity, nothing. In fact, she is quite happy with this. So case to case basis, I said, you have to see the quality of life also. You have to see the cost of the drug and life also. If it is matched, then we should use it. Long term, it can lead to malignancy, it can lead to anaphylaxis. All these things are there. But you have to assess the overall quality of life, whether it is really worth for this patient. So what I want to use, theratide, it is you have to decide on individual basis, not as a blanket.
So basically what you have already very rightly pointed out about the carcinoma, the lung cancer or helminth infestation and other multiple diseases which do occur if you use some particular biologicals. And that's what worries me, that we may be controlling one disease and maybe be making the person vulnerable to the other disease. So that's why the level at which you would like a particular interleukin to a particular level, that has not yet been clearly worked out. And there are people who suffer with side effects. Comorbidities ke bare mein kisi ne abhi tak koi studies mere khayal mein to reported nahi hai. The patient with asthma with other comorbidities, what happens to them of the use of that particular biologicals?
Hey, obviously, only these things are in 10 to 15 years, whatever say. If you say 20 years data and this and that, then it is a different.
That's correct.
But
that's
as
correct.
Such, huh, as such, I don't think safety profile has been found to be very good, because all these products are from the very standard companies, and they cannot launch in the market without the safety profile. So we have to be very, very careful. Cost also. Safety is, I think they have not given any of the negative verdict till date. You may find some negative point later on in life that we don't. But right now, we can't say that it should not be used because of the safety.
With due respect to your statement that these companies are very established and very standardized, if you must be aware of the statement of the editors of very reputed journals that they were pressurized to publish wrong results.
I can't say that.
No, I know you cannot say anything about it.
I have gone through the multi-center trial, and I know they cannot pressurize at all. No, because DCGI is involved, our independent body is involved.
It is a known fact because they have confessed, the journals, the editors of very reputed journals, where the rejection rate is 95%. So anyway, you have answered the question very well, that more studies are needed, long-term studies will be required to understand the
sometimes I tell you, the rare, I reported a case, ethionamide induced synopsia. Well, a blue vision patient after taking ethionamide had developed blue vision. I was surprised. I never read it since many years. I went through whole literature, my resident went. It was the only case in the world literature that after 1950s, the ethionamide is invented. In 2018 or 19, I reported that this is the only case ethionamide induced synopsia. Rare cases may be later on, but right now I think it is worth if you choose the right patient.
Yeah, Dr. Vaidur, you had some questions.
Yes, I would like to ask Dr. Jain,
yes,
that you talked about cost effectiveness.
Yes, sir.
And you compared comorbidities, you compared day-to-day hospital admission, you compared cost of death. That is uncomparable. But I think you should let us know whether you have compared medicines versus IgE biologicals, steroid versus biological, this sort of comparison
should be
more appropriate if you talk about cost effectiveness.
Yeah, for example.
Number one. Number two, you talked about selection of patients. This is very important. And how do you categorize these patients? Because asthma, you say, or allergy, these are multifactorial pathogenesis, all sorts of cytokines, all sorts of chemicals are there. You can target one, but maybe in the pathogenesis, 2-3 IL are liable for this pathogenesis. Please elaborate me these two things.
Yeah, right. For the first question regarding the cost effectiveness, actually cost effectiveness, I have already told you that they consider the hospitalization cost, the medicine cost, many of the things maybe, whether adding these biologicals will help them or not. For example, Japanese studies say that if the patient is hospitalized more than eight times, only then it is cost effective. But if it is 4 times, 5 times a year, I think it is not cost effective. But it becomes cost effective only when the cost of the drugs are also reduced, which is not right now available, except the omalizumab in India, which have reduced, and Indian data are not available. So number one is that the overall quality of life, quality adjusted life of year for 1 year, how much he has to spend with biologicals and without biologicals. That is the criteria they have adopted. Hospitalization, non-hospitalization, and overall death rate, can be avoided. So that was the reason they have opted the cost effectiveness. Number two, selection of patient. Yes, you are said, I chose this topic because there are so many interleukins, so many factors are there in asthma, in the rhinitis, in the dermatitis, urticaria. Still, if you give, there is a, you can say, multiple disease or overlapping allergic disease, a single drug, for example, dupilumab, can act in rhinitis, that can act in atopic dermatitis, that can also act in asthma. Not too completely, but still it can give a good results. That is the purpose that I chose the topic, the biologicals in allergies, not in biologicals in asthma alone. Right? You are right that it will not cover all the interleukins and all the factors. But right now, whatever is available, it is giving the effect on these factors in these diseases also.
I hope, Dr. Jain, this cost effectiveness should have been calculated. You have calculated with the foreign data in terms of dollars, US dollars.
Correct.
Had it been converted in terms of rupees, probably it will emerge to be more, very high and very.
Actually, in the Western countries, the hospitalization cost is very high.
Yeah,
in India, it is still lower. If you go to the small nursing home and the patient gives an asthmatic, it is very low.
Dr. Vaidul Alam has clearly pointed out. Right. Steroid versus or inhalers versus or the other drug routine drug medications.
That is why it is the clinician's version where he thinks the steroids are to be given high dose or it can be added to this.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Dr. Jain. Really, you have given good exposures of the multiple disease in allergic associated comorbidities. My submission is there that biologicals are immune modifier. They are not disease modifier. Why the biological has come in this world? Because 60% of the patients, whether you take the allergic disorders, granulomatous disease, or the autoimmune diseases, 60% of the patients only respond to the steroids. Rest of the 40%, they don't respond to the steroids. That's why in rheumatoid other things, the biologicals flooded with the market. In asthma also, we see that 60% of the patients, they are uncontrolled, poorly respond. And other patients, their comorbidity, they don't respond even to the OCS, oral corticosteroids. That's why biological, they are immune modifier. They are not disease modifier. They decrease this amount of the steroid intake. They may decrease the exacerbations. If one patient, I put on an omalizumab or biological, other patients are put on only on the cost, I prefer to give one shot per month rather than giving daily dose of the medicines or other things. So Dr. Oidullah, a biological is a game changer. It has reduced the cost not only on the exacerbations, not only on the symptom control, not only on the cost also, but moreover, it has also immunogenesis also. You see, if you look at the another thing, so disease modifier. We don't have anything of the disease modifier which is except allergen immunotherapy. We don't have any drug which acts on the decrease the airway smooth muscle mass. We don't have any drug which acts on the healing of the epithelial, which is the core for our allergic disorders or asthmatic disorders. So cost has decreased if you compare with the amount of the medicines the patient is taking. So really, I congratulate you. And one more point which I want to share, that if we select the patients in a state of the pre-modeling, that biologicals will decrease, will have a remission of the disease. That's why you mentioned one case of, we have many cases we put on angioedema, urticaria, along with the bronchial asthma, along with the nasal polyposis, which we giving anti-IL-5, for 1 year they took anti-IL-5. Loss of the smell was the main factor. Even after recurrent polypectomy was done. But once we put these patients on a mepolizumab, there was a less loss, means the symptoms of the loss of the smell decrease. That is the beauty of this omalizumab. At least we are giving the immunity to that particular cytokines, which is immunopathogenic. So biologicals,
what is your question, Dr. Kathuria?
And my question is, think of it, is my comment only, that biological is the only way by which we can decrease the severity, symptom control, exacerbation, as well as the cost. Thank you.
Would you like to respond, Dr. Jain?
Yeah, what Dr. Kathuria is saying, I didn't talk about, or rather I mentioned it, that safety and efficacy is good, but at what cost?
Yes.
For example, if the patient is suffering from a cancer and he is offered this cancer chemotherapy, and you are not going to increase life for 1 month or 2 months by selling his own home or something like that,
is
it like that? That situation should be avoided. You should offer the patient, if the patient, I also said, in children, where cost can be kept aside because there is overall development of child also. In such cases, the cost can be bypassed. But
that your selection of appropriate cases comes into the picture.
Individual basis, you have to select. That should not.
Dr. Nagendra?
Your presentation points very clear. Whatever your presentation was very clear on these aspects.
The summary of the biologicals is this. Even the recent ERS symposiums, they said that it has to be indicated only severe persistent symptoms if it's not controlled with the existing the pharmacotherapy drugs.
True.
And in practice, I feel with the pharmacotherapy, you can initiate with the allergen immunotherapy in the classical allergy cases, and not responding, then you can subject to the biologicals, which may be add-on effect. That may be a better option. And as Anil Jain said, it has to be, counseling has to be done, and we have to give a total information so that they will not get confused. And the cost may be there, but the investment, what you are making, what is the response you are getting, what's the advantages you are getting out of this therapy, which has to be explained. And then only you will be able to get a good quality of life in these patients. And I feel, we had to expose to the biologicals, but we had to apply as and when required to the individual cases rather than a generalized. So when you see, we have done more than 40 years of practice, and in the beginning we saw that inhalers was introduced, and the steroid inhalers, we thought that will replace the immunotherapy.
The break everything.
Hello, Mr. Krishnan, can you mute it? Mr. Krishnan, please mute it. So in the inhalers, we thought that inhalers will be replacing the immunotherapy, but that did not happen. Then over a period of time, then we thought the immunotherapy has shown a better approach because we are understanding with the molecular biology was very, very high in the immunotherapy. And now, right now, we are seeing this disease modifying effect. Now, biologicals will not be having a disease modifying effect, but it's only immunological modifying effect. So with this support, I think we had to understand, and then we had to treat them, and with a proper counseling, that may be a better option. That's what I feel. And also we had to motivate our insurance people to get a reimbursement, at least a part of the immunotherapy has to be reimbursed so that people will get popularized and they feel that the quality of life definitely enhances and repeated hospitalization can brought down and they become comfortable. That is my submission.
Thank you. Is there any other question, Dr. Jain? VK Jain?
VK Jain.
Dr. Gaur?
Can I add one more point to Dr. M.K. Agarwal's?
Don't respond to Dr. Agarwal, respond to Dr. Anil Jain.
No, his question was there that if you give biologicals, there will be something adverse effects like malignancy and other things.
No, what he said, these are all the black box which has been notified in the literature. We should not take it as a priority. It can be taken as a secondaries, and we have to see the maximum effect what you are getting out of that. That is the point what he wanted to explain.
That black box warning was there initially in omalizumab also. And now after giving many of the studies later on done on the base of the omalizumab, because we have got a track record of 20 years of omalizumab, there is no such, whatever the prevalence of malignancy was found, same was in the general population. So that word should not be added and it should not be used. Even in some black box marking, now it has become obsolete. This word has been now taken out with reference to the activations of the malignancy due to the omalizumab.
Do you like to respond, Dr. Agarwal?
VK Jain want to speak something?
Yes, I am. Yeah. First of all, Dr. Anil.
One minute, Dr. Jain. Let Dr. Agarwal.
Wonderful presentation, Dr. Anil Jain, that we have highlighted the role of biological in allergy patients. No doubt they are the new research molecules. They may be having the role, no doubt, when something is coming new, they are definitely have some role, but not in general practice or not in general. What I said, as these biological, most of the time in asthma, we required only in the difficult asthma stage 4 or 5. Otherwise, in mild to, stage 1, 2, 3, 4, we generally do not require these type of thing. Even if they are being advised in stage 4 or 5 difficult asthma, when the patient is already having remodeling, when the patient is already having the fibrosis of the bronchial muscles, the thickening of the, I don't know how these things will work. There may be exposure of these specific cytokines where these specific biologicals are effective. I don't think they will be, because already the remodeling is there. The patient is really requiring more rehabilitations and more of the symptomatic treatment. And I do not know, though the things are coming in literature very nicely, and they are also not very cost effective in practice. It's still in the Western countries, it is too costly. In our country, I think it is also. But we cannot say they are not having role. I agree that they are having role. If rightly used at the right person, specific patient, after proper counseling and selection. This is my comment. I'll not say I'm not absolutely against of it. In his part, that omalizumab is available in India for last decade or more than that decade. Dr. Kathuria is, I still do not know why these things have not yet popularized. In the
literature. You are right, sir. I had been of this opinion that why omalizumab being used at the last stage, you can say, when everything, remodeling, fibrosis, everything has happened. Most probably it is the cost that we are catering the, you can say, the use of the IG at this stage. Had it been at a very cheaper rate, I would like to use it in early stage because that will prevent the late stage disease of asthma. But because of the cost, we cannot use it early. No doubt it is only a modifier. It cannot be a treatment. So yeah. In between IgE use can be used early if the cost permits. And that is why the cost is the factor that we are deferring it to the last stage. So even at that stage, because the IgE load you are reducing or using, some effects are there, maybe 40%, 50%, but not 100%. That is the what you said.
Yes, the early use of the parameters is possible, yes, if the cost permits.
I agree, Dr. Anil Jain. And in my 50, I mean almost five decade practice after doing my MD in 76, you see, whenever a patient of asthma, even allergy, they are coming to me. I have yet to see a patient who have admitted in my whole life. If they are proper, if I am counseling, giving proper time to my patients, counseling properly, asking them to be very regular and sincere for the therapy, I think I have yet to use the, even very rarely, the oral systemic corticosteroids. Even very rarely, my patients are admitted in the hospital. As with at least the rhinitis patient or a rhinitis asthma patient, even very severe stage, people are coming. And last week, we saw a patient from last month, very, he was on multiple antipsychotic drugs. He has been consulted many pulmonologists, renowned pulmonologists. The patient came, he was so much in the depressive stage. The proper is when I counseled for 45 minutes and I gave same drug what their people were giving. And I properly counseled, and now see in last 1 month, patient is 70% improved and he almost stopped all the psychotic drugs except one anxiolytic I am giving, but still, and patient is so happy. I have nothing done. I have given time. I have counseled purpose. Not this my patient, multiple patients. I am practicing very late in Jaipur. Patients are coming from consulting the renowned pulmonologist and in the general practitioners. They are not very happy. The reason is I know they don't, we do not get the time, we don't cancel, the patient is not properly in nasal spray, not taking proper the most of the time we these find, and patient has come such a chronic and very poor quality of life, and he was saying that I want to suicide myself. So this is the picture. We do, the physician do not have a time. Because I have got a five decade experience in teaching also, in the practice also, but I am not seeing 100% or 200%, or if it, I cannot see more than justified 15-20 patients in a day, if I am a really good practitioner. And these diseases are the very common disease being initiated.
Dr. Gaur,
thank you.
Dr. Gaur, you wanted to say something? Unmute yourself. Unmute.
Yes, we want to hear the Dr. Gaur comments.
No, you all know what I will say. But anyway, I will
say only one
thing. I will say only one thing. I don't remember the names of so many Zumabs, means whatever Zumabs are there in the market, all started from only Zumabs. So these are coming very frequently because every time the cost is increasing. Now, one thing I want to know, but if the patient has got allergic phenomena, whether these omalizumab are acting on the basic the abnormalities of IL-2, IL-1, or something, all they are only affecting eosinophils. That is number one. Number two, what happens after when the patient is about 3 or 6 or 7 or 10 months and there is a recurrence of symptoms? In case, again, you give them the omalizumab, why don't you give it the proper treatment of the specific treatment to which he is really allergic, though we have got a facilities to find out the allergy. Number three, what Dr. V.K. Jain says, I think I agree with that, whatever he said. So I'm not using, that's what I'm saying. I'm not using omalizumab because I feel that it is non-specific. It's not neither a bronchodilator, nor an anti-asthmatic, nor it's affecting IL-1, IL-2. It's affecting the eosinophils. And what I want to say in the end is that the level where you want to use the omalizumab started from 3,000 eosinophil count. Now it has come down to 300. And it's very obvious. 300 is nothing for an asthmatic. So means only thing to increase the sale. I'm sorry to say, but this is my feeling that is only to increase the sale of the substance. You should consider that thing also mind. It cannot replace immunotherapy. It cannot replace allergic specific things. Once we have got the specific thing, why we are going on non-specific and that too very costly?
Dr. Anil, would you like to comment?
Yeah, sir. I have.
He's the latest in the biologicals.
In the very first slide, I have told that the oldest biological is the immunotherapy.
Yeah.
But if we use it, practice it properly, unfortunately, it is in the wrong hands, and they are defaming it. So people are losing the faith in this immunotherapy, specific immunotherapy.
That's going against our immunotherapy recommendations.
I used to say to my residents and my colleagues that tuberculosis and asthma are being very badly mismanaged in India.
Yeah.
I usually see this. It's true. Everybody is giving, take the inhalers. Nobody tells how to take inhalers. Even Rotagas, Pupran, Tora Kuskibat Dale, Kuiku Kajarai. This is happening. Nobody tells how to use it. How to use it.
Peach mat dikhao bhai, face dikhao.
My
submissions to Dr. Gaur and other senior colleagues are there that the whole world is worried about the adverse effect of the steroids, whether it is a granulomatous disease, sarcoidosis, asthma, or chronic allergic disorders. We want to give biologicals only to have a steroids paining effect, not only at the same time decreasing all the benefits which we already mentioned. And second point, which Dr. Jain said, that it is not going to help the remodeling. Yes, it does not going to help the remodeling. It is only help to decrease the ongoing inflammation. If you go through this literature, IL-25, IL-33, and TSLP, these are the basic cytokines which is from epithelial. Is there no drug? Even the IL-33 has got a steroid resistant. It is not going to, if you do a lot of steroids, it is not going to help. So it is the only biological which will decrease these epithelial cytokines, because basically it is the epithelial cytokines along with the ongoing closer to the endogenous and exogenous factor which is responsible for the remodeling and inflammation. Biological is an add-on therapy. It is not that. But how long, as you would raise the question, how long?
Dr. 8 years. Kathuria, would you like to use 2-3 biologicals at the same time? But different
theoretically it is
cytokines
okay.
And different
yes, theoretically it is okay, but cost is limited. Limitation is the cost. Otherwise, biological which will decrease the ongoing cytokines from the
epithelial lining. Dr. Kathuria, if you just go to what Dr. Anil Jain has presented in one of the slides, is it affects the eosinophils, but it is not anti-inflammatory. That was in one of his slides. So once he says that it's only affecting to a limited cytokine level, or not even level, only eosinophils. Eosinophils can be affected by so many things. And he said it has proved not anti-inflammatory. Please listen to that slide.
No. It is as Amanizol, you asked me, I will give you 10 benefits of the Amanizol. It is an antiviral. It is after activate the Th1 also. This he is telling is the literature which is already ongoing.
You are also telling literature.
But if you go through the omalizumab track, not 10 benefits of the omalizumab is with us.
When omalizumab was there, RSV. Dr. Kathuria, when the omalizumab was introduced, said it is the best treatment for asthma. When mupalizumab came, he said, no, omalizumab is useless. Now this is the best. Now other zumabs are coming up and the old one becoming bad and bad, bad. So means...
No, they are not the best.
This is all economics, you know. Man, this is all economics. The new one is coming, is better because it is costlier. The old one is useless. When it was science, there, it was the best.
Science.
Anyway,
Everybody knows that we will not. Okay. I will not be convinced.
I will request.
Guria will also not be.
Given of you.
Okay. Okay.
Now cool down and listen to me.
Yeah. No, you practice the way you want.
No. One information just I want to
I
share.
I would like to.
You see that Kathuria has said that it reduces the inflammation. It is not directly reducing the inflammation. It reduces the interleukins and other factors, which is the responsible for inducing the inflammation. So for example, IgE is reduced, naturally the inflammation will come down. But in case of inhalers, it reduces the inflammation, but not the interleukins.
So that's why you had to understand very clearly, it may not be having a direct impact on the inflammation, but once the interleukins comes down, naturally the inflammation will come down. So basically, principally, it is biologicals are very effective, but only the cost factor is the one which has to be noted.
Thank you, Dr. Nagendra. Now, Dr. Agarwal, last question.
Okay, now I would request all of you to please consider only a few factors which I am going to bring out. Number one, science is a stepping stone type of thing. Whatever we know today, we get to know better than that tomorrow. So therefore, whatever we know on the basis of that, Dr. Jain has presented the paper. We have got a big armamentarium of dealing with allergic conditions or asthma. We have got inhaled steroids, we have got antihistamines, we have got bronchodilators, we have got immunotherapy and whatnot.
Corticosteroids.
The basic requirement, what is required is, we treat the patient objectively with the available medications. And number two, we must ensure that the patient is complying. He is a compliant patient. Because many times, as you have, one of you have mentioned, that people do not know how to take the inhalers. They have to be trained that. So whatever patient we say he's not responding to inhaled steroids or inhaled antihistamine, is maybe those who have not been trained properly to take the medications. So properly given medication of whatever is available in our armamentarium leaves very few patients which need alternative treatment with mepolizumab or whatever, biologicals or whatever. That should be, as Dr. Jain very clearly said, it should be on individual patient basis.
Less than 3%,
I do not agree with some of you who said that 40% of patients are difficult to treat. I do not agree with that. If we treat the patient properly, it is not that large percentage of patients of asthma who cannot be treated effectively with the available medications. So therefore, immunotherapy is another thing which should be treated and used. After that, if the patient needs supporting, he is not able to respond, we should select those patients and give them on the basis of merit, whatever biologicals you want to give. However, we should keep in mind that it is very expensive, number one. Number two, it has got its limited duration effect. So basically, these biologicals have got limited role, and we should be very clearly understood that it should be used only a very selective number of patients. That's what I wanted to say.
Dr. Poolwal, you want to say something? Unmute yourself. Unmute.
Yes, yes. Good morning.
Good morning.
Actually, basically, you know, immunotherapy and biological, you cannot mix both the things because immunotherapy is mainly for the prevention of recurrent attacks. But here in the biologicals, you will give the patients who has uncontrolled asthma. Now, they all act at the different side. Like, omalizumab is IgE and antagonist. Then benralizumab and mepolizumab, they are inhibiting IL-5. Now, dupilumab further in the progress will be against IL-5 and IL-13. So that will cover a large part of the cytokines, which are mainly responsible for inflammation in bronchial asthma. So there may be a good options for patients who have uncontrolled asthma and where there is difficult to control asthma. Immunotherapy will not lose its place. It will be there just for the prevention of recurrent attacks. But for the treatment of uncontrolled asthma, I think biologicals will have a good role. That's my opinion.
Agreed. There is no question of that. If difficult to treat or uncontrolled asthma have to be looked after differently. Only thing is that the number of percentage, you all are experts on asthma. You, agar you think over in your clinical practice, how many patients out of 100 you have who fall in that category? Very few. If you treat them with the available armamentarium judiciously, with proper counseling, proper compliance, the number of patients falling in the category with Dr. Poolwal is saying will be very limited. I agree that you need biologicals.
Dr. Agarwal, sir, I would like to say that what you say, difficult to treat asthma or the resistant asthma is very less, around 4 to 5%.
Yeah.
Because the definition of this resistant asthma or severe asthma is that uncontrolled asthma with the full dose of the inhaled steroids or systemic steroids,
subject to the condition, the additional conditions are also taken care. For example, obesity. For example, GRD. If you don't treat all these things simultaneously, the sizable number of the untreated, this severe asthma will be high. And unfortunately, the physicians are making a false uncontrolled asthma. What we say, this pseudo uncontrolled asthma. Please do take care first that all measures to control asthma, compliance of therapy, the additional features of asthma, the contributing factors are addressed first. Only then we think that it should be taken care. It should not be very easy that we have given these steroids and the patient is not responding. No other factor is being taken care. There are so many factors that should be.
Exactly. Thank you, well said, Dr. Jain.
Last, I clear it. You see,
can I ask a question?
Dr. Krishna.
Very quick question. I have those patients who come to me when they ask so many doubts about this omalizumab. I ask them to Google. And afterwards, they said, I will continue with immunotherapy only. I don't want to go to omalizumab.
Good.
So, yeah. Most people are reluctant.
Counseling.
Dr. Krishna, your patients are very intelligent.
I'm in a place in Cochin, Kerala, where they come with the diagnosis and they have all the relevant background information.
They've gone through the Google, Baba.
Yes.
Kathuria, I have last words. I have wait for some time. There are few more interleukins are coming up.
It is ongoing.
We will have more and more Zumabs.
Yes.
There is a big list, sir. There is a big list.
That's what I'm. Dr. Anil Jain has very nicely and presented compromising both the things, I think, both the aspects of disease.
Right. So with this, I think we are coming to the end of this today's session.
And Dr. Kathuria, don't feel bad about we had this.
No.
It's very open. He does what he wants sentence, to do. He will not listen to
Jain also. Last sentence, I will clear to Dr. Jain. In the literature, 60% of the children, they are uncontrolled, 20% they are difficult to treat, 5 to 20% they are therapy resistant.
Time nahi hai, Dr. Kathuria,
50% they are uncontrolled, 16.3% they are difficult to treat, 3 to 6% they are refractory.
Thank you, Dr. Kathuria. Dr. Singh, one minute.
If you read the omalizumab, I think you have got the maximum experience, Dr. Kathuria. It is written, it should not be given in acute stages. Is written
contraindication.
Why you are giving an acute, uncontrolled, severe asthma?
No, we don't give. We give step 4 and 5 only.
So then you wait the patient to go under shock, and then you will start.
No.
Thank you. Now it's my pleasure again to thank both the speakers, Dr. Wahidul Alam, overseas guest from Bangladesh, and Dr. Anil Jain, an eminent pulmonologist from NRTD. National Institute of Tuberculosis and Respiratory Disease.
NITRD, sir.
NITRD, Delhi. And both of them have generated a lot of interest and discussions. It was really wonderful session. With this, now I hand over it to Dr. Nagendra.
Thank you very much, Dr. A.B. Singh. You have done a very good job. And today, both the subjects was very, very catchy and more informative, more practical aspects have been discussed. And it is up to the speakers and up to the practitioners what they want to apply depends upon the individualized and see that total quality of life is enhanced in the patients and affordability. So these are all points were discussed well, and we had to look into the every point as Dr. Wahidul Alam has said. So not only aquarium, maybe other factors also may be there. So one has to look into the facts and see that patients get the total relief. And I thank everyone and having a good interactions, and we enjoyed, and especially Anil Jain has given a scope for more and more discussions and more confusions.
I think this type of topics can help us also.
Yes.
Nobody can be perfect. No.
Yes,
let us share the experiences.
And also a science. This is a science. Keeps on changing. So Dr. Kathuria was telling only omalizumab. Now he is telling with the dupilumab. So this keeps on changing. Another new molecule may come after some time.
and he will be catching
on this. And he will shift to
we have got alpha word from A to Z, no problem.
And also, here's a personalized medicine also is coming with the Zumabs. So you can combine the 0.2 ml with omalizumab, 0.3 ml of dupilumab. So something like that, which is coming in the future days to come also. So these are all facts which is coming up.
Benralizumab is coming in month of April. First week of April, it will be launched in India.
I see.
Benralizumab.
Benralizumab. Yes.
Yeah.
So but I want to know what are the Zumabs which has been approved in India? Anybody knows?
They have taken permission. There is launched by AstraZeneca company, and they have DGCI permission to launch this drug in India.
I see.
Yeah, Benralizumab, and that is IL-5 inhibitor.
Inhibitors. Yes.
Cost will be 31,000.
So that's the difference between mepolizumab and benralizumab. So that is IL-5 antagonist, and this is receptor antagonist. The mepolizumab is IL-5 inhibitors, okay. And here it is receptor antagonist.
Basically, they should be used judiciously.
Yeah.
That's it.
So their side effects are there.
We have to consider
conjunctivitis is a common side effect. Conjunctivitis, blepharitis, they can get because of these
maps. That's why they should be used judiciously, taking full care of the patient's welfare.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll be closing this session and we will see for the next visit after 15 days. And please see that a new subject is titles has to be listed and the speakers has to be listed so that this group will be get benefited. Thank you very much.
And I think 2 days poor attendance could be because of the confusion in the login. So be careful next time. So
sure. I will take care of it.
There are some problems.
So happy Hopefully to all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.